Hello, my friends. In this video, I'm going to build Tamiya's 1:48 scale F4U-1D Corsair from start to finish, including a photo etch set from Edward. Let's do it! In addition to the photo etch parts, I will make some scratch build details. I will call these details background details. Those will be barely visible, but will give the model a sense of completeness and depth. This type of details doesn't have to be very accurate, in my opinion, so I'm not spending too much time on them. By the way, most of the tools and materials I'm using are linked in the description. The photo etch set provides a frame for the seat, but before installing it, I will have to remove the kit frame and to fill the holes that appeared. The photo etch seat looks nice. However, gluing large pieces of photo etch together is not the best way to do things. So I soldered the seat together. I added some photo etch details, but not all included in the kit. Those which are pre-painted, I will attach after painting. On the side walls, along with the photo edge details, I added some scratch build items, using stretch sprue, fishing line and copper wire. As an anti-glare measure, all cockpit panels above the lower edge of the instrument panel were to be painted matte black. I made a very dark gray mix so I can have some shadows. Next up is the interior green. Here I'm using H58 from Mr. Hobby. When painting, I try to apply light layers, so I can gradually build the opacity to where I want it to be. And what I want to do is to get the slightly darker internal edges and all kinds of recessed details. Also, the backside of the additional details I will not attempt to paint, essentially boosting the shadows and therefore the sense of depth. Let's start with black filter to create some soft shadows around the ribs. This black filter is essentially a heavily diluted black paint, which I am shooting at about 0.8 to 1 bar of pressure. Next, I mix lighter version of the base color, and I will apply it on the flat areas between the rise details. In this section of the cockpit, a good amount of contrast will make things somewhat more visible and interesting. With the same lightened base paint, or even lighter, I will go over the raised details to create highlights. Again, the goal is to boost the volume. On some places, this paint can be used for chipping effects, either with brush or a sponge. The same treatment will be done on the black portion of the cockpit. The next step has a dual purpose. Besides creating a bit of dirtier appearance, the panel line wash will create harder shadows. After a few minutes of drying, the excess wash is easily removed. Now, let's move on to placing the pre-painted photo etch parts where they belong. For this job, I use mainly CA glue, but most if not all of the modeling glues can be used. For me, the photo edge details are not always worth the effort, but in cases like those cockpit details, they provide nice true-to-scale appearance, both to the details and also to the needles, marks and symbols. To paint the small details, I use water-based acrylic paints like Life Color and Vallejo. They are much better suited for the job than my favorite paints for airbrushing from Gunze and Tamiya. A drop of acrylic paint drying retarder gives the paints even better qualities. After blocking the main color, I do highlights with lighter color. The good old dry brushing does wonders on the raised details. That's if you pick the right color to get just enough contrast. Recently, I discovered the Citadel paints and that their metal colors are awesome to apply with brush. Using Runefang steel, I did some bare metal chipping. Alternatively or additionally, you can use silver watercolor pencil. After painting some red switches, I did a simple dry brushing of the dashboard. I applied a transparent yellow-orange mix to the backside of the acetate dials that came with the photo edge set. Next, I applied a white paint over the other paint. A few drops of PVA glue are enough to keep the acetate, the photo edge and the bulkhead together. A heavily diluted black acrylic paint helps me create fine shadows layer by layer. Like a glove. After the fuselage is in one piece, I can get the instrument panel shroud upgraded, painted and weathered. First, the eyebrows from the kit take their places. Then I made two cables that I was able to discover on some pictures. Those I made out of soldering wire. I attached them with super glue and then I did the masking tape cable tie deal, which is very effective in my opinion. To paint the shroud, I will use Mr. Surfacer 1500 Black. I will use it not only as a primer, but also as the mine color. I will use that also on some other details. For the cables, I am using acrylic paint. In my paint rack, the closest to what I have seen on the pictures is the desert sand from Lifecolor. For the cable ties, I chose medium gray color. And with the same color, I did some light dry brushing. To highlight the various edges and the buttons on the eyebrows, I used grey watercolor pencil and a touch of red to spice things up a bit. I had to cut the base of the gun sight a bit because the Aztec sheet was in the way. Once the part was secured in position, I painted the padding in brown so it looks like leather. Next, I punched a disc out of clear Aztec sheet. And this will be the reflective screen that the pilots actually look at. To complete this section, I installed what I think is an armor glass and highlighted its edges with the gray watercolor pencil. For the larger and more stubborn photo edge pieces, I use cyanoacrylate glue. Getting a small area at a time glued so I can position and bend the rest of the photo edge detail if necessary. This piping or cable set that comes in photo edge is a little bit hard to position because it catches everywhere on the ribs and so on, but when you try to be a bit persistent and glue each section at a time, it can be done. Also, using soldering wire, I added some pipe that comes across the gear bay, and using small strips of masking tape, I made the hose clamps. The fishing line is very easy to glue using cyanoacrylate glue or super glue. So let's move to the gear legs. First, I had to remove some of the material that was not going to be needed anymore because of the photo edge set, and it's time to put the photo edge accessories and build up the gear legs. I will build them almost entirely before I start painting. I think it will be okay. So with that, it's time to do some stretch building. First, I'm going to put a spacer from a round rod so I can attach the photo edge bracket that is holding the front part of the geared bay doors, and then some brake lines, again using a fishing line. Here also I'm going to use small strips of masking tape to simulate those hose clamps. For the rear wheel, there are those plates which have some holes in them, which holes are not present in the kit. You can leave them like this and paint them black, for instance, but I chose to drill holes where holes are due, so I think it looks a bit better. Now let's move on to airbrushing. First off, of course, it's the primer. Again, Mr. Surfacer 1500 Black. It gives nice foundation for shadows. Next, I'll use the Glossy Sea Blue from Mr. Hobby. This is a color that's gloss, obviously. It is from their nitrocellulose line. Next, a quick dry brush using glossy sea blue with a drop of white. This time the colors are acrylic from Life Color. With the same color, maybe a little bit lighter, I will do the initial chipping that shows some paint that was cheap but not to bare metal. And also I'll use this for some highlights. And here is the chipping done with Citadel Runefang steel and a brush. It's a matter of simply dabbing some of the paint down to the surface in as ununiform as possible fashion. Also the same color I used for some of the hydraulics. And for painting the hoses and stuff, I used again acrylic colors, in this case for the pipe main color and the brake lines I used black, and then with some dark gray I did some highlights so we can have some multi-dimensional appearance to the item. And for the hose clamps I used even lighter gray to enhance their appearance. Then I moved on the center wing section. Here it is important not to forget to drill the holes for the fuel tanks and those on the outer wings that are for the edge bars. Let's start with the cowling flaps. As you can see, the internal surface have no features. So first I will make a template using masking tape and pencil. Next, I will place the template on a plastic card. and I will trim the excess. Now I will cement the pieces in the same spot where are located the corresponding details on the outside surface. The sliding mechanism I will represent only with small triangles. I think this is sufficient. Later, I will add the cable that runs between the levers. Now let's turn our attention to the cowling. I will make the internal structure using thin strips of plastic card. I'm trying to get the new detail exactly under the existing panel lines on the outside. There are some very prominent structural elements in the front portion of the cowling. I have no idea what they are called, but I guess braces is fair enough. I will simplify these details because they are too small and too many to make such an impact, in my opinion. Nevertheless, their presence is necessary. Okay, now it's time to do some painting. First comes the primer. The color combination I have chosen might seem odd or inappropriate. However, this combo is possible, proven by some pictures. Next up is weathering. It's going to be only a black wash because those details are not going to be very visible at the end. Here I will spread the wash all over the surface and I'm going to use white spirit to blend and clean the excess wash. Here I would like to express my gratitude to the people supporting the channel on Patreon. Your support is very important and I hope you enjoy being a patron. The formers and the stringers I will clean up more than the rest of the surface, so they can pop out a bit. I'm going to start with a part that is called interior drain tube. I guess it is for oil vapors, but I may be wrong. Anyhow, I did those using stretch sprue. Next, I'll focus on the crankcase. The distributor housing cover is pretty featureless. To remedy that, I will drill out holes where the bolts are expected to be. And, well, not the most accurate representation of bolt heads, once the wash is in there, it is going to be good enough for the occasion. The rocker drain manifold is also not existent in the kit. so I'll have to make my own. As you can expect, painting starts with the primer. Mr. Metal Primer for the photo edge parts and Mr. Surfacer 1500 Black for everything else. Tamiya's new line of lacquer paints is really good, especially their metal cores. The pigment is fine and the finish is durable, so now those are my preferred general purpose metal cores. Next I will paint some details, like hose clamps on the drain tubes. This is rather simplistic approach but gets the job done. With the same black color I painted the pushrod housings. To give them more definition I added some white to the black paint and I will paint the highlights. It may seem a bit extreme, but once everything is in place, the extra contrast will be just about right. To finish off this area, I will add a black wash. I rarely use pure black wash, but I think on and around the engine it is pretty close to acceptable. It gives definition to the details, but also that distinct oily appearance of an engine. The crankcase I will paint with medium sea grey from Mr. Hobby. For the weathering, first I will highlight the edges and raise details using lighter version of the base core, obtained by adding white to the original paint. The same color I will use for some superficial chipping. For the application I use a sponge because it gives a nicely random chips. As a final step for this detail I will apply a black wash. I apply the wash liberally so everything can get the sheen and the color shift. Furthermore, applied like this, the wash will blend the previous weathering. Moving on to the assembly, first I got the two rows together. Then I will add the photo edge cables, which is a tedious process. And to make things worse, Edward made the cables a bit shorter than necessary. Anyhow, I managed to super glue the cables in place. After super gluing the crankcase in position, I will add the rocker drain suction tube. The tube I will make from 0.5 mm soldering wire, shaped and cut to size. To assemble the exhaust pipes detail and the engine, I will use slow setting cement, because the fit is very tight and I don't want to have the parts stuck before I can fully press them together. Let's start this painting process with the primer. As usual, I will use Mr. Surfacer 1500 Black. For the silver I chose LP11 from Tamiya. This is a very nice lacquer paint which has a tough finish and very decent metallic properties. I'm going to apply the metallic on heavy traffic areas and in general where I want to do some chipping later. After I applied the silver, it was time for a coat of hairspray, which of course I sprayed with my airbrush. I used my set of interior colors for US aircraft from Mr. Hobby to apply a layer of yellow zinc chromate on several areas. I applied another layer of hairspray and then I went over everything with another layer of Mr. Surfacer 1500 Black. This is because in the next step I'm going to do some marbling. And this is going to be done with a lighter shade of blue than the main color of the aircraft. I try to be as random as possible. On the upper surfaces, I decided to add more of the lighter blue to give appearance of more faded paint. The same went for the underside of the tips of the wings because they stay folded on the deck, so they get more sun than the upper halves. For the main camouflage color, I used a heavily diluted glossy sea blue. And I applied many layers so I can see what opacity I have after each layer and decide whether to put one more or not. Here you can see how I built the opacity on the fuselage layer after layer, and I think I put about 4 or 5 layers in total. The idea is that we need just a hint of the marbling that we applied on the airframe earlier. And after some masking, which took me half a day, I added some white to the base color and again in light layers applied it over the fabric surfaces on the wings and on the tailplanes. After some more masking, I will paint the markings on the airplane. And if you want to know how you can make such stencils by yourself, visit the link in the description or in your upper right corner and watch my tutorial on how to make your own stencils. Here again I try to be random so I can get some tonal variation. Let's start with a little acrylic glossy blue and then add some black to it, just to shift the color a bit. If for some reason you are not familiar with the sponge chipping, It is a technique where we dip a sponge end in the paint, then unload the majority of the paint on a paper towel. Then we use the sponge to transfer the remaining paint on the model in the form of randomly placed specks. Now it's time to focus on the chipping. Using some water, I got the hairspray activated. And with the help of a dental brush and a few paint brushes, I started removing layers of paint on specific areas. Let's move on and put the decals in place. Using my default setting solution, the Mr. Mark Setter Neo, I placed the decals and then I removed the excess liquid with cotton bud. Since the solution has not set yet, I can adjust the decals as needed. Overall, the decals went down flawlessly, with the exception of a weird overlapping of the lower wing insignia with one of the attachment points for the edge bars. Granted, the decal has a cutout in it, but it was a delicate dance of the tweezers. After applying each large decal or series of small decals, I used a Gamma Hyper Saw, which is a very strong solution, to help the decals set in the relief of the surface. The solution did almost perfect job even on that lower wing insignia. At this point, I will add the engine and the cowl to the fuselage, so I can get adequate weathering on all sections of the airframe. In previous builds, I had issues with weathering different pieces separately, only to realize that it looks awful when I get them together. The first step of this second weathering stage is going to be weathering with oils, and I'll use mix all brushes for this. I will start with some starship field in areas where some dust would accumulate over time. In my opinion, this color is very suitable for the glossy blue. Like many others, I like using oils for weathering because they are very easy to work with. They are rather forgiving and allow you to manipulate them for extended periods of time. Of course, there are drawbacks, namely that they tend to dry forever and you should leave them alone to do so, otherwise they can be easily wiped off. Most of the tools and materials I use you can find linked in the description. For the areas where mechanics remove panels so they can work on the oily bits, I will use Starship Bay Sludge. I will keep the weathering mostly on the panels adjacent to the previously mentioned because, well, presumably those are away when the work is being done and are cleaner. At least that's my logic. Don't hesitate to comment if you have something to add or disagree. For the more congested areas, where weathering with oils would take too much time, I will employ a panel line wash with colors similar to the Starship Field. And this is Deep Grey from MIG. The goal is again to simulate deposits of dust and dirt in various crevices and tight spots. And to be honest, I am quite happy with how this wash transformed the previously clean areas. With these oil and wash steps out of the way, it is time to try something new for me and use various types of clear varnishes for weathering effects. For the initial overall layer, I went for Tamiya LP24 Semi-Gloss Clear. Finally, for a bit more bleached effect, I went for acrylic matte varnish from Lifecolor. I applied it only on the topmost surfaces of the fuselage as well as on the underside of the tips of the wings. Using a silver watercolor pencil, I highlighted the fasteners on those most removed panels. Moving on to the heat and exhaust stains. If you are interested in a tutorial, I happen to have one for you. And the link is going to pop up in your upper right corner, or you can find it in the description. What I did here is a bit simplified, with a base layer of flat black for the exhaust, the guns and the shell ejection ports. Then a desert sand inside the black on the exhaust to simulate the residue from the lean burning conditions. And then a drop of brown in the desert sand to intensify the color in a few areas. Now onto the fuel stains. I wanted to buy appropriate effect, but there was none available locally, so I was forced to improvise. I mixed enamel wash for DAK vehicles with shaft and bearing grease effect to get a color that I see as appropriate. And then I applied it carefully using a brush. In the first steps of assembly, I attached the flaps and I got together the main gear legs and wheels. As it can be expected from Tamiya kit, the assembly is very straightforward and I had almost no issues. Moving forward with the undercarriage and the fuel tanks getting attached to the fuselage. The majority of the time I used CI glue, but also used various cements here and there and canopy glue where that was needed. Some people asked me in the comments why the seat belts are missing. So here they are, with the slight twist that there is going to be a pilot figure as well. If you are still watching this far, thank you so much. I am pretty sure that you like my other videos, so click on the banner that will take you to them. Once again, thank you for watching and until next time, happy modeling!